This is Kennedy Space Center, Florida. Let's go in and check it out. There is a lot of things to see in NASA Kennedy Space Center, and I've picked just quote unquote three or four things that I would like to see the most. One of them is the rocket garden with many awesome rockets. Another thing I want to see is the Atlantis pavilion, which shows the space shuttle. And then I would like to see the Apollo Saturn V center with the biggest rocket ever built. And of course, I would like to see the SpaceX Falcon launch today. And I think I will probably make it a separate video. So let's go and let's explore.
Rocket data, Juno 2. 23.4 meters tall. First stage propellants, liquid oxygen and kerosene. Wow, this is huge.
Gentlemen, boys, and girls, welcome to the Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex. We will be conducting a 15-minute tour of our rocket garden beginning at 9:30. That is just under 5 minutes from now. Come join us. Mark D at the bottom, that one is a model. All of the rest of these are real rockets. Did these rockets ever fly? No, they did not. If they had flown, they would not be here today. These are leftover rockets that could have flown. The other thing to know about most of the rockets here in the garden is that they were originally military missiles, and we converted them for use into the space program. So we're going to walk up here just a few more steps. And I think this is a spot to get started. So as you're walking up, I want to take you all back in time. We're going to go all the way back to the year 1957. Now, during the 1950s, we were involved in a Cold War with the Soviet Union. We disagreed with them philosophically, and we were competing with them militarily. So imagine our surprise when we woke up one morning in October 1957 and discovered that the Soviet Union had launched a satellite into orbit around the Earth. No one had ever done that before. That satellite was called Sputnik. It was about the size of a beach ball and went beep, 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 beep as it orbited the Earth. Well, we knew we had to respond to that. And in January 1958, we launched our first American satellite into orbit. That satellite was called Explorer 1. It launched on a rocket just like the one you see back here, the rocket with the letters UE on it. That is the Juno-1 rocket. And if you look way at the top, the thing that looks like a big white crayon, that's where the satellite was located. This particular satellite had a Geiger counter built into it. There was a theory at the time that the Earth is surrounded by bands of radiation. A gentleman named Dr. James Van Allen, one of the proponents of that theory, helped to design the satellite. Let Juno-1 rocket lift it off, put the satellite into orbit, and we did prove that those radiation bands exist. Today, they are known as the Van Allen belts. Well, we wanted to launch bigger payloads that we could fit on the Juno-1, so we turned the rocket just like the white one here that has NASA written on it. That is the Juno-2 rocket. We had some early problems with the Juno-2, but one of its first successes was the flight of a probe called Pioneer 4. Pioneer 4 was designed to fly by the moon and take pictures of the moon. We didn't get quite as close to the moon as we hoped we would. We missed it by about 37,000 miles. But we were still learning how to do this stuff. Another rocket we used to launch early satellites is one just like the one right next to us here. Kind of looks like a big Q-tip up at the top. This is a Thor Delta rocket. Now, Thor Delta was instrumental in launching our earliest communication satellites. The very first of those was a big silver Mylar balloon called Echo. But one of the most famous communication satellites at the time was called Telstar. Telstar was very popular in culture. In fact, there was a British rock group that wrote a song called Telstar, named after the satellite. Now, it was great. We were learning all these new skills, getting a lot of good information by launching satellites into orbit, but we wanted to put a person into space. We recruited military test pilots, and we selected seven of the best and the brightest to become our first astronauts in what was called Project Mercury. And these guys were really competitive. They competed with each other in lots of different ways because each one of them thought that they were going to be the first person in space. And you know what? They were all wrong. Because in April 1961, the Soviet Union launched Yuri Gagarin into orbit. He was the first person in space. He did one orbit of the Earth, and we had egg on our face again. We were still running behind in what was becoming known as the space race. But less than 1 month later, May 5th, 1961, we launched our first American astronaut into space. His name was Alan Shepard. He launched on top of the Mercury Redstone rocket, just like the one over here with the red United States, the black and white stripes, and that black bell-shaped capsule is the Mercury capsule. It held one astronaut. Shepard's flight went up 116 miles, arced over the Atlantic Ocean, splashed down in the Atlantic near the Bahamas. Total flight time, about 15 minutes. Just 20 days later, President Kennedy said, "We are going to send a man to the moon and return him safely by the end of the decade." Well, NASA's response to that challenge went something like, "Wait just a minute. We've had a grand total of 15 minutes experience in space. We've flown all the way to the Bahamas, and now you want us to go to the moon?" But they did accept the challenge. We had one more manned mission with the Mercury Redstone rocket, but we really wanted to put an American into orbit around the Earth. To do that, we needed a bigger rocket. Well, we turned to the Atlas rocket, just like the silver one over here. And if you look at the top, again, you will see a Mercury capsule. Atlas was our first intercontinental ballistic missile, or ICBM. Again, we converted and produced it into the space program. And in February 1962, John Glenn became the most famous man in the Western world when he became the first American to orbit the Earth. He did three Earth orbits and had a very successful mission. We had three more manned missions on the Mercury Atlas rocket, and by the end of Project Mercury, we had proved that man can exist in space. We discovered our eyes weren't going to bug out and our blood wasn't going to boil. But if we were going to get to the moon and back, we had to learn how to work in space. We moved from Project Mercury to what was called Project Gemini. And the Gemini capsule held two astronauts. If you look over here, you see the big silver rocket with the black and white stripes on the bottom. That is the Titan II rocket. Again, originally built as an intercontinental ballistic missile. But if you look way at the top of this one, the black thing up there is a Gemini capsule. We had a number of firsts that were part of the Gemini program. We had our first American spacewalker, Ed White, with Gemini 4. We had our first rendezvous in space, where there were two Gemini capsules in orbit at the same time, Gemini 6 and 7. Now those two...
And unfortunately, we lost all three astronauts. And that was a tragedy. But at the same time, it was a wake-up call for NASA. They pulled back. They totally re-examined the Apollo capsule. They made over 1,300 changes to it. And a little less than 2 years later, October 1968, NASA launched Apollo 7 on a Saturn V rocket, just like the one you see here. That mission was so successful that NASA said, for our very next flight, we are going to the moon. But to get to the moon, we needed an even bigger rocket yet. Well, we turn to the Saturn V. Now, we don't have all eight. We sent three astronauts to the moon, put them in orbit around the moon. On Christmas Eve, they sent back a very moving photograph of the lunar landscape with the Earth rising in the background. Very dramatic photo sent to the entire planet. We followed Apollo 8 with Apollo 9, 10, then July 1969, we did land our first man on the moon with Apollo 11. All right, let's do a quick quiz. Who can tell me the name of the first person to set foot on the moon? Just shout it out. Neil Armstrong. There we go. Now, how about...
But I want to get closer, so I will take a bus to a launch pad viewing platform.
Watch the water on the edge of the bank for alligators. If I see one, I'll point to him.
Space Center is surrounded by the Merritt Island National Wildlife Refuge. While the refuge in total takes up 140,000 acres, NASA only occupies about 7,000 acres. Other than the few launch pads and facilities you see spotted across the horizon, this area remains a refuge for 150,000 species of plants and animals.
That's one small step for a man, one giant leap for a mankind. Neil Armstrong.
The Eagle has landed in honor of the Apollo crew and the men and women who made their space flight possible. Collins, Armstrong, Aldrin.
Just look at this beauty. This is Saturn V. That was a rocket NASA built to send people to the moon. A heavy lift vehicle. It was the most powerful rocket that had ever flown successfully. The Saturn V was used in the Apollo program in the 60s and 70s and was also used to launch the Skylab space station. The rocket is 363 feet tall, about the height of a 36-story building and 60 feet taller than the Statue of Liberty. Fully fueled for liftoff, the Saturn V was pretty heavy, 6.2 million pounds. A car that gets 30 miles per gallon could drive around the world around 800 times with the amount of fuel the Saturn V used for a lunar landing mission. It could launch about 130 tons into Earth orbit. The Saturn V could launch about 50 tons to the moon. It's just awesome. The rocket was developed at NASA Marshall Space Flight Center in Huntsville, Alabama, and was one of three types of Saturn rockets NASA built. Two smaller rockets, the Saturn I and 1B, were used to launch humans into Earth orbit. The Saturn V sent them beyond Earth orbit to the moon. The first Saturn V was launched in 1967 with Apollo 4. Apollo 6 followed in 68. Both of these rockets were launched without crews. These launches tested the Saturn V rocket. The first Saturn V launched with a crew was Apollo 8. On this mission, astronauts orbited the moon but did not land. On Apollo 9, the crew tested the Apollo lunar module by flying it in Earth orbit without landing. On Apollo 10, the Saturn V launched the lunar module to the moon. The crew tested the lunar module in space but did not land it on the moon. In 1969, Apollo 11 was the first mission to land astronauts on the moon. Saturn V rockets also made it possible for astronauts to land on the moon on Apollo 12, 14, 15, 16 and 17. On Apollo 13, the Saturn V lifted the crew into space, but a problem prevented them from being able to land on the moon. The problem was not with the Saturn, but with the Apollo spacecraft. And the last Saturn V was launched in 1973 without a crew. It was used to launch the Skylab space station into Earth orbit. And to fully appreciate the sheer size of the rocket, you just have to walk around and underneath it. It's a marvel of modern engineering, no doubt in my mind. Home of the space shuttle Atlantis. You remember space shuttles, don't you? And if you don't, maybe you read about it or maybe you saw some movie. But in any case, I think it's worth seeing it. Let's go and check it out. Atlantis was the fourth shuttle constructed and the last one to fly into space. It performed well in 25 years of service, flying 33 missions that included secret missions for the US military, ferrying astronauts to and from the space stations, and launching several probes. The shuttle gained a reputation of being the unsung workhorse of the shuttle fleet because it sent so many satellites into space. It also has the distinction of flying the final shuttle mission before the fleet was retired in 2011, I think. Atlantis flew many, many missions. For example, in 1995, it made 7 straight flights to the former Russian space station Mir, as part of the Shuttle Mir program. It marked a number of firsts in human spaceflight. For example, 100 US crewed spaceflight, first US shuttle Russian space station Mir docking and joint on-orbit operations, and first on-orbit change out of shuttle crew. When linked, Atlantis and Mir together formed the largest spacecraft in orbit at the time. Atlantis delivered several vital components for the construction of the International Space Station, ISS. During the February 2001 mission to the ISS, Atlantis delivered the module, the primary operating facility for US research payloads aboard the ISS. The first mission flown by Atlantis after the Space Shuttle Columbia disaster was conducted during September 2006. In May 2009, Atlantis flew a 7-member crew to the Hubble Space Telescope for its servicing mission. The mission was a success, with the crew completing 5 spacewalks, totaling 37 hours to install new components to the telescope. And that was the final mission not to rendezvous with the ISS. The longest mission flown using Atlantis lasted 14 days in June 2007. So it was a major, major accomplishment in the US space program, wouldn't you say? I definitely think so. And I think my visit to Kennedy Space Center is coming to an end. There are definitely more places to see, to visit, but I picked just the ones that most interested me. I was not really very interested in the interactive exhibits for youngsters, and I wasn't much interested in watching movies, which they have many. So thank you very much for watching. I hope you liked it, and see you next time. Goodbye.